Today, we are, of course, starting with the latest on the coronavirus pandemic. Yesterday, Prime Minister held another press conference where he said that extreme measures are on the way. And with the news that there are now 1,950 confirmed cases here in the UK and 71 deaths, the situation is ever-changing.
Well, to discuss the very latest, we're joined by Dr Philippa Kaye and psychologist Laverne Antrobus. Welcome both.
Welcome both of you.
Thank you for coming in today. What did you think of what he said? I stress, although the measures are extreme, we may have to go further, faster.
So I think it's really important that we walk the very, very fine line between people understanding how very serious this situation is and not inducing panic and civil unrest and all of that will go with it. But this is hugely serious and we are asking people to change their behaviour. And in order for them to change their behaviour, they need to understand why they are doing it. Mm. And it's as simple as this. If you walk outside in the street and you are infected and you have symptoms, every time you bump into a person going in or out of a shop or just bump into them in daily life, 5% of those people, 1 in 20, will end up in hospital, in ITU, and some of those will die. So by staying at home, you are saving lives. It is that important that
just,
we do it.
Just by bumping into someone?
If you coughed, bumped into somebody, coughed, you know, and they breathed it in, then yes. And we don't know necessarily who that 1 in 20 is. You can't guarantee that you're not going to be meeting somebody that's more vulnerable than you.
And so this increase in deaths, you know, although you read out those numbers and they're growing every single day, is not surprising.
So although it's really tragic and really sad for the people and their loved ones, it is not unexpected. We are still on the sort of upward slanting part of this curve. There are going to be more cases every day, and that means, unfortunately, there's going to be more deaths every day for at least for a little while longer. And that's why we're really asking people to be really stringent about their behaviours at the moment.
And I think also, you know, we stress all the way through this that, yes, we're changing our lives. Yes, things are different. But clean water still comes out the tap. The power is still on. There will still be food in the shops. And this is temporary.
There is still food in the shops. So there are some messages around that there aren't. But there is. And maybe you can't have pasta today and you can have a potato instead. So there is still... There is light, there is sewage, there is all of those things. And you can do what it is that you need to do, but maybe a little bit differently. And maybe it's an opportunity to slow down a bit.
Should we be worried about the level of unknown cases?
So... we are always going to have unknown cases. Children can be asymptomatic shedders, so they cannot have any symptoms at all and be out there. And we think that adults as well potentially could do that. So we're never going to truly know the numbers that are out there. And that's why we're asking everybody to be careful.
It's believed that there could be up to, with a suggestion of 55,000 unknown cases.
Yes. Yeah.
And is that a figure that you agree with?
I would say so, yes. And I would also say that now we're not testing people unless they are going into hospital. We aren't going to truly know. And the reason that we're not testing is because it's not going to change what we do. So in medicine, you do a test if it's going to change the outcome. And it changes the outcome if you're going into hospital, are you going into the COVID ward or are you not? But for most people who are going to be mild, stay at home for a week, 2 weeks, depending if they live with someone or not, it's not going to make a difference.
Can I ask you, today it's been reported about these testing kits that you can buy online. Some of them are sort of £350. You send off for them and they can arrive. It seems almost unethical that you can buy these if you've got the money to buy it, when we know full well that our staff within the NHS, our frontline teachers, who are now having to isolate for 14 days, won't get tested. Yep. They are desperate for these tests. And yet, if you've got the money, you can pay and test yourself.
So not only is it profiteering, and we know that profiteering happens in every war, they're not very good. They're not very sensitive, they're not very specific, so you're not going to necessarily get a true answer. So you're much better off following the guidance. If you have a cough or a fever, don't waste your money.
It could tell you that you've got flu rather than actually
COVID. So it could tell you that you don't have COVID-19 when you do.
Oh, right, OK, well, then...
Well, that's not worth 300-odd quid then, is it?
No, it's certainly not.
What about some of the stories that are confusing? which are then also wrapped up in what we would now say was fake news.
Yeah.
Because we know that, I think you say that in a lot of the fake news stories, there is the teeniest thread of truth and everything else is built onto that by people in their armchairs who think they know better than the experts and then post something and away it goes. Ibuprofen.
So this one is something that actually does have a smidge of truth in it, and the guidance changed just yesterday. So in France, they were talking about how potentially people who had ibuprofen did worse with COVID-19. The evidence is not very robust. It's not really clear. Mm-hmm. But because of that, the NHS yesterday said in the afternoon that everybody should start with paracetamol first. Mm. If you're taking ibuprofen for a long-term condition like rheumatoid arthritis, for example, there's no reason to stop it. If you're an asthmatic in general, you shouldn't have it. But for everybody else, let's try and start with paracetamol first until we know more.
And the fake news part of that was we were talking to Health Ireland yesterday, and there were four young people who were in hospital very seriously ill in Ireland, and that's not true.
Laverne, why... I mean, you're a psychologist. Why do people share fake news? Is it because they don't know that it's fake news? Is it because it taps into that area of our psyche where we're just so fearful that it just spreads?
I think it's a combination of those factors. I think that, you know, as you said, there is often this tiny little thread of truth, and that what fake news does, it sort of appeals to people. You know, it's often sort of sparks some sort of anxiety or concern. And I think that then grows in momentum sometimes. I'm also quite concerned that, you know, people that are reading news often feel that they're getting it from platforms that they can trust, you know, or friends. And so there's a way in which the momentum grows, and the retweeting, the sort of seeing of it, that makes people think, well, this might be true. But it actually feeds into a part of our psyche, which is our worldview of things.
And you see it, it seems to be sort of WhatsApp groups as well, family WhatsApp groups, school, parent, teacher WhatsApp groups, where these things are sort of being, I mean, they're going off constantly. It's like ding, 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 and there seems to be more information coming through that than anywhere else.
And I think at the moment, because we're in this extremely worrying phase, you know, people's minds are a little bit sort of, you know, overwired to try and find some solutions to the things that perhaps they feel they're not being told. We've just gone through a period of, you know, people, experts, not being believed. And so this fantastic gap appeared for fake news, whereby people could then sort of get in there, and their opinions, because they're often opinions, have filled this gap.
But it's also very dangerous. A YouTube video falsely and dangerously advising people to inhale hot air from a hairdryer to cure the coronavirus. There was another one, drinking water every 15 minutes to ensure you swallow coronavirus, then your stomach acid will kill the virus. Yeah.
So it won't. First of all, if you were to kill it by heat, you'd have to probably blow hot air up your nostrils every single breath, which is not going to work. You're going to just burn yourself. You know, don't do that.
And it can get in through your eyes.
Yes. So it tends to attack the respiratory membrane. So swallowing every 15 minutes is going to keep you nice and hydrated, which is good for us, but it's not going to do anything because it's already attacked your nose and mouth. So I would be really careful where you got your information from. The NHS website is being updated on a more than daily basis. That's your safest place where you know that the advice is correct.
Okay. All right, guys. Thank you very much indeed for the moment.